There is a place that is spoken about only in whispers. A dark area that spawns the beginnings of urban legends. A place where anything can happen and usually does. During the light of day, it hides just outside of view. But when the sun goes down, spirits, creatures of the night, roam free, and things do go bump in the night. It is in every state and every country, and there is no escaping it, no matter how safe you feel behind your locked doors and latched windows. So we invite you to turn down the lights and turn up your radio while we join Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis, your hosts, on a journey into the darkness on the edge of town.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the show. Our second hour is about to kick off, and as you just heard, we're talking to Mr. Adam Bly about demonology and parapsychology, and we're just playing a commercial for our Queen Mary event coming up, and as it would just so happen, one of our next guests is also going to be joining us on the Queen Mary. If you have Court TV, you've probably watched him on that show, Haunting Evidence, which is an amazing show. They've taken a paranormal investigator, Patrick Burns, who's our guest, and two psychic-sensitive medium profilers, John Oliver and Carla Barron, and brought them together. They go in and they try to reinvigorate a cold case file, which means it's a case that has gone cold. They haven't gotten any clues. They don't really know who the killer is or what happened in the case. So they're looking for any outside help. So they've actually called in these three experts to come in and they go in and try to reinvestigate and maybe open up a few new clues to help out with the cases. Our guest this evening is Mr. Patrick Burns. Good evening, Patrick.
Hey, Dave, how you doing?
Doing great. Thank you very much for joining us again this evening. Appreciate having you back.
Always a pleasure.
So let's talk a little bit about Haunting Evidence. Now, again, it's Wednesday nights, correct?
It's Wednesday nights. We are off the air until the new series, the new season, premieres, which will be June 13th. So everybody has to hold tight for about another 6 months or so. If they've never seen the show and they'd like to see what it's all about, though, they can go to hauntingevidence.com or courttv.com/haunting, and they can actually watch the premiere episode from season one right on the website there.
Awesome. And again, like I said, it's basically you and John and Carla going out to cold cases and trying to reinvigorate and get some life back into them, right? And hopefully
yeah,
show some
detail.
Yeah, it's
kind of a new twist on a crime show, investigative process in getting some answers for these cases. Some people have compared it to Unsolved Mysteries meets Psychic Detectives.
Sure.
Sort of got a similar feel to that.
And right now you're in the middle of filming season two, correct?
Yep, I just got off the road. In fact, on Friday I got home here. We have five episodes for season one in the can, and that's going to do it for 2006. We're going to pick it up again the second weekend of January, and we'll just pick it up from there and do the remaining episodes for the next season.
Well, the question I got to ask, because you know everybody out there wants to know it, have you guys been able to solve one of the crimes yet, or do you think that you've gotten really good information and helping the police close in on a character, or are you not at really liberty to say because that is an ongoing investigation for the police and you don't want perhaps the killer to know that you guys are closing in on him?
Well, the law enforcement they're generally very hush-hush with what they tell us in terms of the show, because it is, as you said, an ongoing investigation. They're open cases. There have been some very interesting new clues that have been uncovered by John and Carla in a couple of the cases that we have worked, that law enforcement has been sort of had to stop and say, hey, wait a second, they're really onto something, because we didn't publish any of these clues publicly. There's no way they could have possibly known this. So our experience with law enforcement on the show, Dave, has been...
Jay,
kind of
Dave, whatever you want to call me, Paul, it's
whatever.
Fine.
The Dave. Okay. The Dave. The show has been mixed. Some law enforcement are, very, very eager to work alongside John and Carla and see what they come up with. And then others are just complete cynics, we don't believe in this stuff, yet we'll appear on the TV show, just you know, just to do our job and you know, give you some background info on the case. So none of the cases has officially been solved yet, but you know, I remind everybody that I tell or I talk to rather about the show, I say, now, you know, you got to realize that we've only been filming now for just over a year. You know, these are still very much cold cases, and in instances where psychics have become involved in these cases, you know, they may have been involved with these things for years before they finally got closure. Law enforcement certainly is in no hurry to rush to prosecute. You know, there have been a number of instances in the past, you know, Jean-Benet Ramsey being one, where they thought they had an open and shut case, and they botched their investigation, you know, by being too hasty. So I know from experience they're very interested in some of the details that John and Carla have been coming up with, but I just want everybody to sort of, you know, be patient, and we'll see what happens in the next few months.
Now, have they ever considered having one of the mediums confront a potential perp, you know, I mean, who they think may be it? Do they ever have them kind of do a psychic lineup, if you will?
Yeah, I think the problem that we run into there is from a legal perspective, you know. In most of these cases that we've done, they don't even have an official suspect. The one exception to that that comes to mind is the case of Julie Williams and Lolly Winans. Those were the two female hikers in Virginia on the Appalachian Trail that were brutally murdered at their campsite. They have a suspect in behind bars who has assaulted other women in the Appalachian Park, and there's good reason to believe that he was in the park at that time, but they just haven't been able to pin it on him. And John Oliver has said he was like, you know, I'd love to go and meet with the guy and just look into his eyes, talk with him for a little while. John seems to think that he could be able to tell us one way or the other if this guy was really guilty just by looking at him. But of course, again, there you run into a liability problem. You know, you can't say, well, John said he did it, so he did it. It's a really sticky situation. And
well, that's what I'm curious about. When they reopen these cases for you, Patrick, and they're letting you guys get all this information to try to help them get this. Now, let's say John goes to the murder scene and of Sweet Polly Purebred and finds out that it was Simon Bar-Sinister that did it because he can see her in his mind and he knows these things. But there's no physical evidence tying Simon Bar-Sinister to this site. There's no evidence of Simon Bar-Sinister having been in this area, but he can give a dead-on, even a name kind of thing. How does that help on these cold case files? If they already thought, well, it might have been Simon Bar-Sinister, but we have nothing to tie him to.
Right. They're very cautious about giving out specific names. They instead prefer to to, you know, profile, give a physical description, and let law enforcement sort of you know, pick up the pieces from there. You know, it is important to remember that psychic abilities have never been proven from a scientific perspective. So it's kind of fuzzy intelligence, if you will, in terms of its accuracy. You know, there are going to be days where John and Carla are dead on, and then there are also going to be days where, you know, they're wrong, and they would be the first to admit that. John, in particular, has said, you know, on several episodes, he said, you know, I may be wrong about this, and I hope I am, but this is what I'm seeing, and, you know, so it's kind of a sticky situation there to really try and, you know, implicate somebody, you know, unless you have more concrete, solid evidence.
Patrick, you know, based on the case that Dave gave you, this is Tim, by the way, it sounds to me like you need to drop a psychic and get Underdog, because he just gave you Polly Purebred and Simon Bar-Sinister.
Right.
Yes, but, you know, right now, Underdog's really tired because he forgot to fill his ring with the energy.
That's right, man.
Energy pill.
Yeah, so. Underdog is a druggie.
Yes,
he knew
was.
It all along.
Hippie.
What sort of message does that send to kids?
Well, you know, it says that if you take your vitamins and
oh,
you're a good
right.
guy,
yeah.
you know, and polish people's shoes, you too can be a superhero.
Yeah,
don't mess with me. That's one of the only tattoos I have is my underdog tattoo. All right, Patrick? All right.
Vitamins that are controlled by the FDA.
That's right. So you've got these cases going on. Now, has there ever been, are you aware of any cases that are closed because of help? Now, I know we watch the TV show Medium, and
sure.
Alison Dubois every week saves the day by giving these cases, and they figure out a unique way to circumvent they find a way to circumcise the evidence. No, but they find a way around it that they could nail these people. How are you familiar with real cases actually taking place that way? We put out the call to Alison Dubois to be on the show, and of course, at this point, she's a little too busy with the show and everything they're doing. We haven't gotten a call back.
Absolutely. Haunting Evidence was built from the ground up as a companion program to Court TV's other psychic abilities program called Psychic Detectives.
Right.
Now, the primary difference between Psychic Detectives and Haunting Evidence is that Psychic Detectives is entirely reenactments. These are known cases that were aided with that were closed with the aid of a psychic investigator, or a psychic profiler, or a medium, or what have you, went into these cases, gave law enforcement clues that aided them in closing the case. So in the span of 30 minutes, everybody, we go to case closed, and this is who did it, and this is the amazing evidence that the psychic came up with that parallels, what law enforcement discovered. And difference with Haunting Evidence is these are actual, they're still very much cold cases, and we take the viewer in to the actual investigation. It's literally the first brush that the psychics have with these cases, taking them to the different crime scenes and whatnot. So it's easy, I think, to compare us to psychic detectives and say, what the heck is going on? Why isn't there any closure here? You're leaving us hanging. And, that is one of the unfortunate things about Haunting Evidence is most of these episodes, I fear, are going to be cliffhangers, but sooner or later I'm hoping that we will get some resolution in a couple of them. But if people want to see cases that have actually been closed with the aid of psychics, watch our companion program, Psychic Detectives, on Court TV. I believe it's on Wednesdays at 10 p.m.
Now, let me ask you this, too. With all of the stuff that's going on with you guys trying to open these cold cases, are you aware, have you or any of the other members of Haunting Evidence received some nasty emails or mails from people saying, you better get off our back, stop coming after us, anything like that?
Yeah, that's one of the fortunate things. Myself being the paranormal investigator on the show, I'm just looking for changes in the environmental variables and taking some photos, hoping to get something to sort of corroborate with John and Carlos to sort of complement their interpretation and say they're on the right track. While they were feeling this, we were measuring this activity. Maybe it was a sign from the other side that something was trying to nudge us that we were on the right path at that moment. I have been told that at least one of the other members of the cast has been threatened in at least one of the cases. There was another case that we did earlier this year where the perpetrator is believed to still live near where the victim did, and while we were filming, the victim's family told us later on off camera that we were being watched by who they believe did this crime.
Really?
Obviously, I can't tell you who this was, but yeah, we were being observed by somebody going up and down the road very slowly on a four-wheel ATV, and it was when we found that out. That was
maybe he just thought you were really cute, Patrick. You are a good-looking man. It's
Well, thank you very much, Dave.
Tim Cruise is by your place all the time, watching you.
What's that?
Sorry,
you're not supposed to tell.
Anyway,
him that.
You're right.
So you've had these little experiences, but nobody is. I mean, thankfully, no real death threats or problems from.
No, not yet. Knock on wood. I will say this, the second case that we filmed was Tara Baker. She was the University of Georgia law student who was murdered in her apartment in Athens, Georgia, which is less than 45 minutes from where I live. And I was actually the one that brought the case to Court TV's attention after my friend Sherry had, who worked for the Baker family, had sort of tipped me off to it as well. So that one was a little unnerving for myself. I was like, you know, what if I'm just down the street? What if this guy decides to, you know, come pay me a visit? But you know, so far,
see,
so
maybe
good.
That's the one episode. If I'm the paranormal investigator, I go, gee, I'm getting nothing. Yeah. Sorry, can't help you.
Exactly.
Sometimes you can't always be the hero, Patrick. Just remember
yeah,
that. You know, what's actually interesting is I wish we had a John Oliver with us at the last Stanley retreat.
Yeah.
And I say this gingerly, and I won't go into detail, so please don't bother emailing me and asking me for more. But I believe I was introduced to JonBenet Ramsey's murderer while we were
really?
There. Yeah. Because it was shortly after my introduction to this person that one of the Boulder County police people that were at the event, actually weren't even there for our event, but were there just visiting, noticed him and asked what we were talking about. And then he clued me in on who this guy was. And
this was somebody who was attending the
No,
the
he wasn't. He wasn't one of our guests. He just happened to be at the Stanley and is interested in the paranormal himself. How strange is that? You know, again,
wow.
It could just be stories. It could just be they're
sure.
just trying to freak me out. However, I thought it was pretty interesting, and
that
and
is,
it just
yeah.
shows to go you. You just don't know who you're running into out there. But yeah, it would have been interesting to see if this was one of those moments because
absolutely,
you know, afterwards.
Well, John has told me that he doesn't get involved in cases unless he is approached by law enforcement. A lot of psychics are contacted by family members after you know someone has died or gone missing, and John has a very interesting answer for that, and I won't say too much about it because I'll let him elaborate if you manage to get him on the show at another point. But he has said that.
Oh sure, rub it in my nose that I can't get him on the show. Nice job, Patrick.
Well, I'll see what I can do.
Had you been able to manage to get him on?
Right, but he said that he won't do it for virtue of the fact. What if the family contacts me, and it's the father who's guilty, and I know this? How can I, you know, figure
right.
this guy as the guilty party, and you know, not upset the family? Rightfully so. So, he's told me that he only gets involved in these cases when he's contacted by law enforcement.
That's interesting. Yeah, because that actually would have been one of the main questions I would have asked. I think we even asked Carla that when we had her on.
Yeah.
But we're going to take a quick break. You're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. Our guest is Mr. Patrick Burns from the TV show Haunting Evidence on Court TV. We'll be back with more right after this.
Adopting aliens and giving them good homes since 1953. Just don't tell our landlord.
E.C. phone home.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
It's Dave and Tim shacking up in the darkness on the edge of town.
For 58 years, Fate has consistently supplied its loyal readership with a broad array of true reports of the strange and unknown. Fate is a factual magazine containing articles by experts in all walks of life, and by others just like you who have something dynamic, significant, and truthful to say. Keep up with the latest on angels and miracles, psychic phenomena, ghosts, UFOs, archaeological hotspots, alternative science, and much, much more. To receive your free Fate magazine, call now at 1-800-728-2730 or visit our website at www.fatemag.com. That's 1-800-728-2730 or www.fatemag.com. What are you waiting for? Your fate awaits.
Okay, each of you youngins take a gun, a beer, and some smoke.
Throttle circuit breakers in. We have separation. Inboard and outboard, they're on. We're coming forward with the side stick. Looks good. Roger. I've got a blowout. Neighbor 3. Get your pitch to 0. Pitches out. I can't hold altitude. Direction. Alpha hold is off. Trip select is emergency. Flight calm. I can't hold it. She's breaking up. She's breaking.
Oh my God! They killed
Dave.
You bastard!
Dave Schrader. Paranormal host.
A man barely alive. Gentlemen, we can rebuild him. We have the technology. We have the capability to make the world's first bionic
paranormal host. Dave Schrader
will be that man. Better than he was before.
What is it that makes you set...
Better. Stronger. Faster.
Run, Forrest, run! Run, Forrest!
Welcome back to the Darkness on the Edge of Town with Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis.
And welcome back to the show. I'm your host, Dave Schrader. Along with me, my co-host, Tim Dennis. You're listening to Darkness on the Edge of Town radio show, and our guest this evening is the beautiful and talented Mr. Patrick Burns, who is one of the, I hate to call it stars because it sounds strange saying that. You're one of the main people on the TV show.
Right, I guess. One of the haunting evidence. That's fine. That works.
You're one of the celebrities
haunting
evidence, and you're just fab. We love you here. Queer Eye for the Paranormal Guy is now underway.
Yeah, I love that commercial, the $6 million man edit. That's great.
Yeah, Tim made that for me. He, you know, just a good guy. He makes
it's
all
my
the
tribute to it.
That's right. All the commercials, and all the intros and outros you hear are made by the equally lovely and talented Mr. Tim Dennis.
So what you're saying is Tim does all the work for you, and you
pretty much. I'm his puppet. I'm not even here. I'm nothing but a hologram of myself, and Tim moves my lips.
An audible hologram.
Sounds kind of dirty. All right, so let's talk a little bit about Patrick Burns. Patrick, aside from doing the TV show, you also host something called Ghost Stock, which is not unlike Woodstock, where you all get together, smoke a lot of weed, and check
Absolutely.
Out ghosts.
Absolutely. Man, you wouldn't believe the ghosts we catch dropping acid.
Oh, I bet.
You know.
I hear ghosts get the best weed, too. Is that true?
Yeah.
Excellent. Excellent.
We got Jimi Hendrix there, and John Lennon is going to be checking in. No.
A little Janis Joplin?
Yeah, Janis is Excellent. There, too. Yep. No, seriously, Ghostock is a paranormal conference that we do in Savannah, Georgia.
There's some bad ectoplasm being passed around Ghostock.
Right.
Don't take the ectoplasm.
Don't take the brown ectoplasm. That's right. It's really bad, man. I had a bad trip last night, dude.
So, no, it's actually in Savannah. You have it's a group, a gathering.
Yeah, it's our little spirited weekend of spirits, as we call it, and Savannah, Georgia is just an amazing town. It's really one of the very few towns in the South that was spared General Sherman's torch during his march to the sea during the Civil War, so it's really, from a historical perspective, if you're a history buff, Savannah is Southern history personified. It's just an amazing town. And we do this twice a year. We're rolling into Ghostock 4 now, which will be held February 1st through the 4th in Savannah. And we're actually upgrading to a larger hotel to expand and accommodate more guests for this incarnation of the event. But it's a lot of fun. We have speakers, and we go on investigations, and we review evidence when we go out to do these investigations. Everybody comes back and reports on what they found. And people that are interested in going, that we've piqued their curiosity, they can go to Ghostock. That's GHOSTOCK.com and read up on it there. We're expanding the guest list right now. But
I heard you might even have that dynamic ball duo from that crazy radio show, Darkness on the Edge of Town, showing up at your...
It's a very distinct possibility.
Very cool. Well, I hope they show up because I hear they're really cool in person.
I do, too. I can't wait to meet them.
And of course, we're talking about the, beautiful people from Ghostly Talk, right? Is that...
Yeah.
No, sorry. So you're going to have this out. Now, do you know who some of the speakers are that you currently have lined up?
Our very good friend, mutual friend, Dave, Russ Clark, is going to be there.
Okay, great.
Yep, he has signed on for the event.
I hear he gets good drugs too. So
that's what I hear. I'm hoping he does. I'm hoping he hooks us up.
I wonder if he could just hypnotize us to think we're on good drugs.
Yeah,
that might be the better way to go.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Okay, so you're going to have Russ out there talking about hypnosis and the paranormal.
Russ is going to be there. John B. Kachuba, who is...
We've had John on the show. Sure, yeah.
Right. He's author of a book, Ghost Hunting on the Trail of Mediums, Dowsers, Spirit Seekers, and Other Investigators of America's Paranormal World. What a mouthful that is. But
that is right.
That's his book, and he's going to be talking about it and have autographed copies for sale there as well. James Caskey, who runs Cobblestone Tours out of Savannah, one of the top haunted tour companies in Savannah. They do a great haunted pub crawl, and after about your fourth or fifth round, I guarantee you, you're going to see some spirits.
Yeah, and you'll definitely be crawling from pub, won't you?
Exactly, yes, yes, it's aptly named. Some guy named Patrick Burns is going to be running his mouth about something long-winded.
He's on, like, one of those cooking shows, isn't he?
Yeah, I think so. I think he's on Food Network. And our favorite guest, he's coming back for, this is going to be the third time we've had him there, is Murray Silver. He's a fifth-generation Savannian. He was booking rock concerts in Atlanta when he was 16 years old back in the 1960s.
Wow.
You know, at the time when everybody was getting their driver's license, he was like bringing supergroups like Pink Floyd, Genesis, Paul McCartney, George Harrison, Bob Dylan. These supergroups of the 70s, he was bringing them into Atlanta with the aid of his father and booking rock concerts. He was also the tour photographer for the Sex Pistols during their only tour of America in 1977. I mean, how cool is that?
Very cool.
I'm just blown away. I'm starting.
You do know that this isn't a rock and roll meeting, though, right? What does he do with the paranormal?
Absolutely, absolutely. He's had a number of experiences with the paranormal himself. I mean, living in Savannah, there's no way to get around that. And
sure.
He's written a book on ghosts called Behind the Moss Curtain. And he's just an all-around amazing, amazing guy. And like I said, fifth-generation Savannian. If anybody's going to be able to tell you about Savannah's ghosts, it's going to be him. And he just mesmerizes the crowd every time. Everybody's like, bring back Murray again. So we're bringing him back for the third time.
Awesome.
And we're also adding some other guests. We've got some people that have expressed interest in attending but haven't confirmed yet, but... we're close to getting that wrapped up, so I'm not gonna say anything until it's a done deal. But all I can tell your listeners is to keep checking ghoststock.com and click on the featured guest link to find out who's been added and who's in for the lineup.
Excellent. And yeah, like I said, Tim and I are doing our best to hopefully get out there and attend with you. And if you need a couple more speakers,
absolutely,
we'll help you find them.
Absolutely.
We'll be doing that. Now, let's talk a little bit more, too, about your personal experiences in the paranormal. Now, you're quite busy with the show and Ghost Doc and your real job in real life. And are you still doing paranormal investigating yourself, aside from the show and, you know, and doing that?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Yes, I am, actually. I don't get to get out there as often as I would like. Of course, I'm married. I have two small boys, and my wife is interested in this as well, and... she's not always really crazy about playing babysitter while Patrick gets to go out and chase spooks around. So we typically try to find a babysitter.
Women can be so ununderstanding about that.
Totally, you know?
Yeah, my wife with six kids just doesn't understand why she shouldn't stay home with the kids.
Right, yeah.
I get a lot of crap for that. She'll be coming along with me on some more of these trips, I believe, in the future here. But no, I'm with you on it. Yeah, that's got to be tough having kids. I understand. We go through the same thing at our house because I am tied up doing so much of this stuff. I've only been out on a couple of small expeditions for ghost hunting out here. But are you still doing them? I mean, if people have problems or troubles out in their area, can they contact you for help?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, we approach each case on a per incident basis. And if we deem that, an investigation is in order, then, I typically try to assemble a team and send them out. I don't personally go on every investigation these days. I've sort of encouraged the ghost hounds to organize their own investigations and get out there and just come back and report back. But I do try to get out at least once a month, if not more. But with my shooting schedule and everything else going on, Sometimes it's a little tough. It probably averages, I think, to be about once every 2 months.
Well, how about with the paranormal investigating that you're currently doing? Has there been a new case that's really kind of knocked you off your heels and made you think, oh, my God, what's this?
In terms of places that I'd like to investigate, you mean?
No, I mean, what kind of evidence have you collected, you know, since you started the show, still doing the paranormal?
Oh.
Is there anything that just really kind of went, wow, holy crap, this is unreal?
Yeah, this last case that we did was very interesting. We investigated a cold case in the Washington, D.C. area, and the victim's body was placed in the Potomac River and presumably drifted downstream about 10 miles from D.C. They don't really know. They're not certain where her body was placed in the water, but it was discovered on the banks of the Potomac. And, you know, we took Carla out there during the day, and she was doing her interpretations. I was taking photographs. And then at night, we went back out to go near the crime scene, but they decided to charter a large boat to take us out there on the river. And they had John on the bow of the boat, and Carla's on the stern, and I'm in the whatever they call it on the boat, where the wheelhouse, where the captain sits and all the instruments. I've got my table set up there with my rig, and, you know, I'm thinking, gosh, you know, we're out in the middle of the water. I don't know if we're going to actually get anything.
Right.
And my sensors were doing some crazy stuff on this one. I couldn't explain it. As we came into the location, we drifted up and down stream over about a 500-yard patch of the river. And normally, I have a barometric pressure sensor is one of the probes that I use on my rig. And I'm not so much interested in detecting any paranormal activity with that. What I'm more interested in is, do we get a higher incidence of paranormal activity, say, on the edge of a front, when a cold front or a warm front is moving in?
Sure.
And the barometric pressure goes up or down accordingly, is there more paranormal activity going on? And, you know, being able to chart this, we would be able to look back at the graph and say, okay, this is the exact, here's the edge of the front as it's rolling in, and the air pressure starts to drop. I noticed that the barometric pressure sensor was dropping after about 20-25 minutes into our session, and I thought, oh, that's interesting.
Right.
It's never really done anything before. It looks like we're in for a change in the weather. And the captain of the boat said, no, actually, according to the weather forecast for tonight, we're supposed to be calm. I said, okay, that's a little odd. And we watched the bare pressure just keep dropping, and then it baselined again. It leveled out for about 10 minutes or so, and then it started to rise. It started to go back up, baselined out again, started to fall again. I mean, even the captain of the boat had never seen anything like this before.
Well, you know, couldn't that be, though, as you're just going over the hills and valleys under the water?
Yeah.
That it was absolutely picking up the pressure from the you know, because I've gone out fishing with my in-law, you know, my father-in-law, and he'll drop that little fish depth finder.
Well, this
thing
was at the surface. This is the actual barometric.
Right, I know that,
pressure.
But I'm just wondering if the barometric pressure was able to tell the difference as you were floating over different depths of water.
Almost like a depth finder.
Yeah, because,
interesting.
Because
interesting.
As it got deeper, I wonder if that would change the barometric pressure, and as the water got more shallow.
Yeah, I don't know if that would, if what is underneath the water would affect the bare pressure on the surface of the water.
Well, you'd almost
question.
Think so, because if the water, there's more volume in a deeper pit, but the water is still pretty level across the top.
I see what you're saying. Right.
I wonder if that pressure from there, because they've shown and they believe that one of the main things that happens at the Bermuda Triangle is it's actually like gas bubbles being emitted from the bottom of the ocean.
Right.
And when it comes up, it's kind of like a supersonic burp, and it kind of
pulls
stuff down and knocks off their deal. I'm wondering if that kind of pressure and that kind of stuff is being gauged while you're, because how many times have you gone out in a boat with the
This is the first time, and
right.
you have a very, very, you bring up a very interesting point. That's very good. I did have the captain actually lock down the coordinates of this location with his GPS.
Okay.
So maybe at some point in the future, you know, maybe I'll fund my own little expedition out there to the Potomac River, and we'll revisit this location and put your theory to the test, Dave.
You know, you probably wouldn't even have to do that if you just went out and got one of the depth finders on a boat for fish depth finders, and then you can kind of see when the bottom's dropping out and see if your barometric pressure is dropping. You wouldn't even have to do an expensive one. You know, Tim and I will come out and we'll rent the boat and go fishing for a weekend with you.
Absolutely, let's do it.
As long as you do the rowing, because Tim and I are lazy, lazy men.
Oh, yeah.
Right. So. We'll wait until the spring. I'll come up there to Minnesota, land of 10,000 lakes, and we'll go bass fishing, Dave.
Awesome. Sounds like a plan. Now, I don't mean to steal your thunder on that. So doing these changes, did John and Carla feel anything out there?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. They usually pick up on something when we're doing a reading or doing a session at a location. My instruments don't always act up, though. You know, that's just the nature of paranormal investigation, is if you're looking for tangible data that you can log, you don't get it in every location. So,
okay.
They were definitely picking up on something. John had put forth an interesting theory, because it wasn't just the bare pressure that was going up and down. Magnetic fields were in flux in ways like I have never seen them before, doing sort of the same thing. It would baseline, drop off, baseline, rise, and baseline again. And John had proposed the possibility that, you know, if you believe in the theory of ley lines, you know, I'm sure you know all about ley lines.
Right.
He felt we may have actually encountered a ley line out there on the middle of the Potomac River.
And why don't you, just so the listeners have a better handle on it, because I don't want to speak out of turn, I have a general working of what ley lines are, but why don't you give the benefit of the doubt to the listener that they may not be as familiar with it, and
well,
help educate me a little more on it, too.
Sure, the most famous ley line is of course, supposed to be the Bermuda Triangle, and this is just areas where lines of energy, like you have lines of force with the magnetic field of the Earth going from magnetic north to magnetic south. Well, there are also other lines of energy that sort of crisscross in different patterns. And when these lines cross in certain areas, you get a hot spot, which they refer to as a ley line.
Right.
At least that's the theory as I understand it.
It's like triangulation. So all these things are crossing, and where they cross, that point is where all hell breaks loose.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
So
the theory anyway.
Well, that so you're able to pick that up on this. Is that going to be shown on the episode then, hopefully?
Oh, I'm sure.
Great.
I'm absolutely certain of it.
But I was also asking, though, still doing the personal investigations, what do you feel in the last 2 years has been the best bit of evidence that you've gotten on your own that's not part of the show? That, I mean, while you're out investigating in Georgia, is there something that just really took you off and knocked you off your socks going, holy crap, that's amazing?
Yeah, boy, we had some crazy stuff going on at Ghost Stock 2,
right?
Which was last January in Savannah. We were staying in an old boarding house that dates back to the Civil War era. They did like an $11 million renovation on it in, I think, 1998, and it's now, you know, a beautiful 4 or 5 star hotel.
Right
there in the heart of Savannah's shopping district. And, you know, we've heard all the stories about this place and the activity that was going on. I mean, we would hear children running up and down the halls of the hotel during the night and, you know, peek your head outside the window and there's nobody there. And this has been reported from guests time and time again. I guess Alec Baldwin was staying there, and he's actually friends with Murray Silver, and he was telling Murray a funny instance about when he was staying at the hotel. He said, I heard these kids running up and down the halls all night, and I called the front desk, and I said, who are these kids, and where are their parents? And they said, well, Mr. Baldwin, unfortunately, the children's parents are dead, and so are they. And
wow.
Yeah, it was... It was pretty interesting. Savannah is just, it's so amazing because every other storefront, and this really isn't an exaggeration, I mean, every other location you walk into has a ghost story. And it's just a matter of fact to these people. You know, it's not even like they blush or, you know, look at you funny, like, you know, are you going to believe me if I tell you this? They're like, yeah, we have a ghost. We call him George. And he does this, and he opens the doors, and just about every night at 6 o'clock, you'll hear him walking up the steps, you know. And they just say it so matter of fact that it's just fascinating, and you know, it's a great place to just go and you know, collect these stories. I mean, you could write probably 3 or 4 books on the ghosts of Savannah alone, I think.
Let me ask you this. This is a question, as we're talking about this, it just kind of hits me, and I know it's probably going to come out sounding really stupid as I'm saying it, but, you know, I'm interested in knowing about this. With residual hauntings, they always seem to happen at the same time, at the same date, either every night at 6 o'clock when Grandma would come downstairs to, you know, make herself some tea, we hear the stairs creak, and so on and
right.
so forth. Now, have you, this is a two-part, have you done a lot of investigations of residual hauntings?
I have done some.
Okay. Now, my other question would be, do they, and this is the part that's going to sound really queer, but do they coincide with daylight savings time? If every night at 6, I don't mean that sarcastically, but I mean
no.
it. If every night at 6, Grandma came down.
Absolutely.
When the clock flips during that time of year, does it match up?
Right. That's a very good question. In terms of the residual hauntings that I have looked into, they've lacked that all-important repeatability factor. You know, it's still kind of a chaotic event. Okay, they reported happening every day at such and such, and then it's nearly every day. Yeah, I guess it happens about every, maybe 2 or 3 times a week. So it's like, as you investigate, as you go into it more and more and you get people to talk about it more and more, it's not quite the event that reproduces, like clockwork.
Well, of course, because if it was that clockwork, people would be, you know, news stations from around the world would have picked
Absolutely.
That story up by now.
Absolutely.
And been out there recording.
That's very interesting. You know, you talk about, like, the anniversary of certain events, you know, a traumatic event, you know, maybe a murder occurred at a location on such and such a day. Okay, are they going by the day on the calendar, or are they going by the day of the week? You know, it was the third Saturday of December, or, you know, it was the 23rd of September. You know, that changes. I'm very curious about that as well. I don't know if there's anything to anniversaries with residual hauntings, or if it's just
right.
you know, just a nostalgic kind of thing for the ghost hunter. You know, while
too, because you'd think that same effect would happen. Oh yeah, every night, every year on the anniversary of their death, you can hear them, you know, cry
sure.
out or something like that. What happens on a leap year?
Yeah, exactly.
Does it have that
Very
effect? You know, I mean, that's interesting because it throws things off, right?
Right. Well, you know, also I think. In terms of these anniversaries, you have investigators that are specifically keen in on those dates.
Right.
They may get this activity at other times of the year as well.
Right.
But, they'll key in on that date and watch it like a cat on the anniversary. And,
sure.
Of course, they may actually pick up something and say, hi, isn't this cool? This happened actually on the anniversary of this event. So.
Well, you're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town radio show. Our guest is Patrick Burns from TV's Haunting Evidence. We'll be back with more with Patrick right after this.
Don't you dare move. There's more to come from the Darkness on the Edge of Town with Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis.
For 58 years, Fate has consistently supplied its loyal readership with a broad array of true reports of the strange and unknown. Fate is a factual magazine containing articles by experts in all walks of life, and by others just like you who have something dynamic, significant, and truthful to say. Keep up with the latest on angels and miracles, psychic phenomena, ghosts, UFOs, archaeological hotspots, alternative science, and much, much more. To receive your free Fate magazine, call now at 1-800-728-2730 or visit our website at www.fatemag.com. That's 1-800-728-2730. Or www.fatemag.com. What are you waiting for? Your fate awaits.
Hi, this is Russ Clark. If you're a regular listener of Darkness Radio, by now you have certainly heard my radio commercial regarding my hypnosis products. Well, I'm here today to tell you that these products work. These products have worked for many, many people, including some listeners of Darkness Radio. I stand behind my product 100%. If you give it a try and you find it doesn't work for you, you can always return it to me for 100% of your money back. Plus, I'll pay to ship it back to me. That's how convinced I am this will work for you. In addition to that, you can contact me via email anytime with any questions that you may have. I promise this will work for you. So if you want to quit smoking, lose weight, become less stressed, manage some pain, or beat some insomnia, definitely check out my website at www.powerhypnosis.net or call 866-570-3544 and ask for me personally.
If you read Taps Paramag every month, you'll be able to tell the difference between the absurd.
Could not go to work because Bigfoot stole my car.
And a creepy. Taps Paramag takes you where few would ever go on purpose. From exclusive interviews with the cast of The Ghost Hunters to the latest trends in technology in the field of the paranormal. To join our journey, order at tapsparamag.com.
Do you love to travel? Do you love to explore the paranormal? Then join Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis from Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show as we take our show on the road. January 14th and the 17th, we'll be going to sunny Long Beach, California to investigate one of the top five haunted spots in the world, the haunted Queen Mary. Joining us on our journey are the lovely ladies of TV's The Ghost Hunters, Donna LaCroix and Lisa DeWallaby, paranormal investigator Patrick Burns from Court TV's hit new show, Haunting Evidence, and psychic-sensitive Chris Fleming from Dead Famous on the Biography Channel. Together, we'll explore the mysteries and history of this famous floating haunted playground. Joining us will be some other special guest speakers and authors. It's a great chance to meet others that are involved in the paranormal and share your interests. For more information and prices, visit our website at darknessradio.com, then click the Trips tab, then click on the Queen Mary. Remember to check back for information on upcoming trips as well. And tune in live each Sunday night to hear a new episode with Dave and Tim and their guests covering all aspects of the paranormal on the Darkness on the Edge of Town.
When Dave was a young boy, he once awoke to find himself staring directly into the eyes of a shadow person. Turns out it was just his life-size cardboard cutout of Donny Osmond. Welcome back to the Darkness on the Edge of Town.
Good evening, everybody, and happy holidays coming up here soon. I'd like to wish you and all of yours a very healthy, happy, safe holiday. We hope you'll all be back with us after the holidays, listening to the shows, and being safe. Remember, this is a crazy time of year for travel. Be careful when you're out driving. Be aware. Remember to take some time with the family. They are very important to you. And if you make your time with your family now, love them. Don't leave anything out there hanging. There's no need for talking to people like John Edward. As John Edward is so kind and fond of saying at the end of his show, if you do your job in this life of talking to the people that mean the most to you, you don't have to use somebody like John Edward to talk to him in the afterlife to make amends and to fix things. I only mention that just because we do take things for granted, and this is the time of year for a fresh start and renewal and time to mend bridges and be with friends and family, and we just wish you all the best for the next year. Our guest this evening is Mr. Patrick Burns, and now that we're all feeling warm and fuzzy and sipping our cocoa, we'll go back to Patrick here on the lines with us. Patrick, so we've got Ghost Stock coming up again. Give the dates for Ghost Stock.
That's February 1st through the 4th in lovely Savannah, Georgia.
Okay, and for information, people can go
to GhostStock, GhostOck.com.
And if people are interested in talking to you or getting help in Georgia, where can they look up information on Patrick Burns?
That is on Ghost Hounds, GhostHounds.com.
Did you think that, you know, when you came up with that term, did you realize how close to it sounding like ghost towns?
Oh, yeah. We get that a lot, too.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. But it is at GhostHounds.com.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. I know. It's difficult to sort of roll it off your tongue.
You ain't nothing but a ghost hound.
Yeah, that's it. Again.
Crying all the time. Yeah, all right. So you can go to GhostHounds.com. As a matter of fact, every Sunday night, if you listen to the show live on Sunday nights, you can go to GhostHounds.com and click on their chat board, and you can go in there and talk with other fans of our show and
yep.
share and spend some time.
Investigators.
That's right,
Para
Investigators channel.
Yep.
So that's available.
Right,
yep, good deal. And then also now, for people that are interested in getting more information about the TV show Haunting Evidence, since it's going to be a while before it's back on the air, where can they go look up information on that?
That's CourtTV.com/haunting.
Okay.
And they can actually view the web premiere of the very first episode that aired last June right there on the Court TV website if they've never seen the program and they'd like to get an idea of what it's all about.
And did you say there was also HauntingEvidence.com?
HauntingEvidence.com, yeah. Basically, it's a redirect. It's the same
okay.
same thing. Right. Yeah.
And then MySpace, that you've got a page up on MySpace people can contact you as well.
I do, as does everyone these days.
That's
everyone
right.
And their mother.
How can people add you there?
That's myspace.com/ghostgeek.
Ghost Geek.
G-E-E-K.
Okay. And you'll be able to find them there. Otherwise, if you go to darknessradio.com, we have a link on there for our MySpace page. Click on that link, and it will take you to my page here. And if you go into my top friends, I've got Patrick Burns up there, so you can connect with Patrick that way as well. Patrick, let's talk a little bit about a couple other things. Now, first off, I wanted to mention something to you. And, you know, I'm certainly not trying to get John or Carla off the show, but there's a really interesting medium, psychic, sensitive, whatever you want to call him, that we had on our show, and he's going to be with us at the Queen Mary. His name is Peter James.
Yeah.
Peter claims most hauntings, he believes most spirits stay where they were killed or where they died.
Yep.
That would be interesting. He claims that he can speak to him there. I would think maybe you guys should have him on your show in the future to see if he picks up on something right there.
It would be very interesting. And I subscribe to that theory as well, the difference between spirits and ghosts, of course. A ghost being someone who is stuck in between this life and the next life, and a free spirit being someone who has crossed over and can come back.
But you believe that if it's a ghost stuck here, it's probably stuck at the point of death?
Yeah, in most instances, I think. But I'm not totally sold on that. I believe that they may be stuck here, and maybe they're stuck following around a specific person. You know, if they have unfinished business in this life that they were not able to complete. Maybe they follow around a particular person. Maybe they're staying behind because they want to be there for their children in some capacity.
Sure.
And so they sort of hang around them. But I believe Hans Holzer was the one who sort of first came out with that theory, in that the ghost is actually, there's a difference between the ghost and the spirit. The ghost is stuck here because of unfinished business, because, you know, maybe in some instances they don't even realize that they're dead. They died in such a quick, traumatic manner that they're sort of wandering around in an ethereal daze. And then I think, you know, maybe some of them stick around out of fear of being judged. You know, what's behind door number two? I don't necessarily want to be damned to hell, so I'll stick around here with what I know, what's familiar, and you know, they sort of
damn you to hell, Patrick Burns. Damn you to hell.
That's it.
Get off my yard, you little punk. So so you believe that could be it? All right. Well, that's a good theory. I want to ask you, and you don't have to be a tough guy now, Patrick. We're all friends.
Oh, here it comes.
Nobody
here
listens
comes.
To the show. Have you ever really just been scared crapless doing
an
investigation?
Totally. Totally.
Okay.
I was dude run like years before Brian on Ghost Hunters was. There is a video clip out there someplace, and I'm doing my very best to track down all remaining copies and destroy them.
Is that the one with you and Tommy Lee on the boat?
Yeah. No, this is another one.
Okay. Sorry.
That one, I've already gotten that one all taken care of.
Is it that Hot Nights in Atlanta video with Paris Hilton?
Yeah.
Excellent.
That's a Loch Ness.
Come on, man. You're undermining me. Okay?
It wouldn't be so bad, but they have the footage of you dressed as the cheerleader.
Right.
Okay. So, no, go
ahead. There's the video of me hightailing it out of the restroom at Anthony's restaurant here in Atlanta. We were there with CNN a couple of years ago, and they were hearing the toilet paper roll spinning on its own in the ladies' restroom. Of course, the restroom was closed, and they had a video camera set up in there, and they're like, Patrick, you got to go in there and check this. And thank goodness the CNN camera guy had already left. And I walk in there, and you can see me walk in on the video camera, and I sit down in a chair across from the stalls, and no sooner had I sat down than, sure enough, you hear the toilet paper go tick-tick-tick-tick-tick. And, man, I just... It's like in the old cartoons, you know, when you run through the wall and there's that outline.
That's right.
I mean, I swear to God, that's sort of what I did. I made a straight line for the door, and you know, I uttered out a few expletives and.
Excellent. Well, we're going to look for that.
My whole team.
I want you to know we are going to try to play that on the air as soon as we can find it on YouTube. So it will be a part of our site. Patrick is going to be cool enough to join us at the Queen Mary event 14th through the 17th of January, and also at the Stanley event when we return to the Stanley for our Rest in Pieces return tour. And that is going to be March 29th, 30th, and 31st. And I'll tell you what, Patrick, that was crazy cool. I don't know yet. I haven't been to the Queen Mary. I'm really hyped about it, expecting a lot. But right. The Stanley was amazing. And
that's what everybody's
fun.
Telling me, man. So, I'm stoked about both of the trips.
Right. So now the Queen Mary, though, that's coming up. That's going to be interesting. You're going to do a talk there for us. Kind of give us a little bit of your history and share some of your evidence that you've collected over the years.
Yeah, and I may even have that video of me hightailing it out of the bathroom. I may show that.
Excellent. Very cool. Well, Patrick, if there's anything else that you've got coming up, let us know now.
That's pretty much it, Dave.
All right, we pretty much covered all of it for you.
I think that's it for
great.
Up through like February or March.
Well,
so.
Patrick, thanks again for joining us. You're a real true gentleman. We appreciate having you on the show with us. Let us know as changes are coming in. Let's talk after season two kicks off for you again.
Sounds good.
Is it going to be more than 9 episodes, or are you guys shooting another 9?
Yeah, we're doing actually 13 for this one.
Fantastic. Well, congratulations and continued success with the show Haunting Evidence. Keep watching and set it on your TiVo. It'll begin again in June. They'll probably start rerunning the old shows. Our guest this evening was Mr. Patrick Burns from the TV show Haunting Evidence. You can check out his information about his upcoming paranormal event at ghostdoc.com. That's ghostock.com. Or you can go to his website at ghosthounds.com, ghosthounds.com. We'd also like to thank Adam Bly, our guest from the first hour. And we want to make sure that if you didn't hear the first hour, we had the lovely Lisa Dualaby from the TV show Ghost Hunters on. And Lisa, Donna LaCroix, and Paula Donovan have put together a Divas of Darkness calendar to benefit breast cancer. Go to divasofdarkness.net. to get the information and order your calendar to help breast cancer awareness. Thank you very much for tuning into The Darkness on the Edge of Town. Have a happy holiday, and we'll be back with you again next week.